thanks a lot for inviting me. It's my pleasure to be with you. Today is the day after the United States in 2003 conducted its illegal war against Iraq. I just want to say something about our language. We talk about the Iraq war. There is no such thing as the Iraq war. There is the United States war that was imposed on the people of Iraq. There's no such thing as a Vietnam war. You know, there's no Vietnam war. There's the United States imposed war on Vietnam. There's no Afghan war. I mean, look at the way the language distances conflict. It's not a US war that was imposed on the Afghan people. It becomes the Afghanistan war, the war in Afghanistan, the Afghan war. It's not an Afghan war. It's the US war imposed on Afghanistan. There is no Iraq war, okay? In 2003, March 19th, the United States used devastating force illegally against the United Nations Charter to attack the country of Iraq. It's not an Iraq war. It's an American war. It's a US war. The United States prosecuted that war. The United States is responsible for that war. Its allies, United Kingdom, responsible for that war. If we had a just world order, George W. Bush and Tony Blair would appear before the International Criminal Court for having prosecuted an illegal war. Now, I use the word illegal. I'm not using the word illegal morally or out of being personally outraged or anything. This is not a matter of personal taste. It's an illegal war because a year after that war began, UN Secretary General Kofi Annan, who's, you know, basically not a person with any great anti-American sensibility, Kofi Annan went on BBC. It took him a full year after that war began. On BBC, Kofi Annan said it's an illegal war. It goes against the UN Charter. It's a war of aggression for which there should have been some accountability, but there's never accountability. Well, look, that war starts, and as a consequence of the two wars that the United States government prosecuted, the war against the Afghan people in 2001, the war against the Iraqi people in 2003, as a consequence of these two wars, both on the flanks of Iran, the United States delivers the Iranian people, the Iranian government, a strategic victory. Because in a flash, the United States government took out two of Iran's great adversaries, the Taliban on this side, on the eastern side, and Saddam Hussein on the western side. You'll remember that it was the United States government and the Gulf Arabs, including Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, and others, that paid Saddam Hussein in 1980. They paid Saddam Hussein to prosecute a murderous 8-year war against Iran. Was that an Iran-Iraq war? That was not an Iran-Iraq war. That was a war that the West and the Saudis and the other Gulf Arabs paid the Iraqis to prosecute against the Iranian people. That was not an Iran-Iraq war. That was also a war imposed on Iran. United States, the Federal Republic of Germany, provided Iraq with the mechanism to develop chemical weapons to use against the Iranian people. So Saddam Hussein, a historical enemy of the Iranian people, and the Taliban, knocked out by not the Iranians, but by the United States of America. So in 2003, Iran now, without adversaries on either borders, stretches its wings into the region. And the United States, the CIA in particular, saw that this was a huge disaster conducted by the US government. I was reporting this, the whole argument for this, by the way, is in my book, The Death of the Nation, The Future of the Arab Revolution. I'm showing this to you because it has all this evidence in it. It has all the stories because I reported these wars. I traveled to Afghanistan, to Iraq, to Syria several times during the war. I reported this war, but I also met serving CIA people. And they would tell you directly that these were the two most idiotic wars that the United States has ever prosecuted. And let me tell you, the United States government has prosecuted some some really idiotic wars. There's a long history of prosecuting idiotic wars, including the war prosecuted against the Vietnamese people. You know, when people say things like, well, Vietnam, you know, it's not really a socialist country. Try building socialism after your country has been bombed to smithereens by the United States, who used chemical weapons and destroyed agriculture in the central part of Vietnam. And then you have American left figures saying, well, you know, they're not really socialists. But good luck to you. What kind of socialists you've been socialism you've been building in the United States, I'd like to see that, judging the Vietnamese after you've destroyed their agriculture by bombing it with chemical weapons. You know, it was called Agent Orange, but essentially that's a chemical weapon. So the Iranians stretch out on both sides of their border. You see some renewed activity, linkages renewed with Hezbollah and others. And it's at this point that the United States, egged on by Saudi Arabia, but you know the US government doesn't need much egging on. Egged on by Saudi Arabia, egged on by the Israelis, tried to put Iran back to its borders. And so what do you see? You see the 2003 Syria Accountability Act. The attempt to destabilize the government in Syria begins long before the events in Daraa in southern Syria. It begins long before the so-called Arab Spring. It begins with the 2003 Syria Accountability Act, where the United States tried to break the connection between Iran and Syria. That goes back to 2003, friends. That doesn't start in 2011, 2012. It's a great misreading of the history of the Middle East to believe that somehow the United States should have entered there to help human rights of the Syrian people in 2011-12. It's a great misreading of history. The intervention by the United States, by the Obama administration, nothing to do with human rights. It had everything to do with this attempt to break the cord between Syria and Iran. And you see that in the 2003 Syria Accountability Act. It then moves to the green-lighted invasion attack, terrible attack of Lebanon by Israel to attempt to smash Hezbollah in 2006. That was green-lighted, and Hezbollah came out of that stronger, actually, than it was before the war. It comes out as the victor of that war. And the third event that begins to in order to push Iran back to its borders is this whole nuclear facade. It was a facade, let's face it. There was no nuclear threat from Iran. The whole thing is a concocted mess by Western intelligence. There was no threat. At no point had Iran said that they're going to become a nuclear power. Look at the hypocrisy. I'd like to just put the hypocrisy before you. India is not a signatory to the International Atomic Energy Agency's, India is not a signatory to the Non-Proliferation Treaty, not at all. India is not a signatory to the NPR, and yet India has twice exploded nuclear weapons, 1974 and then in 1998. Twice India tested nuclear weapons. Iran, on the other hand, is a signatory to the Non-Proliferation Treaty, allows inspectors from the IAEA into Iran, and has never tested a nuclear bomb. And yet India and the United States in this period crafted a very close strategic alliance, and Iran is the problem. And people in the United States believe, therefore, that Iran is a problem. That's extraordinary. I mean, evidence be damned, you know, evidence be damned. This is akin to believing that you know, whatever, the UFOs are landing in somewhere, or that the devil is a real creature, or whatever those surveys show you about what people believe. It doesn't matter what the reality is. The fact is they've demonized Iran deeply and made Iran into the principal problem. And a lot of these wars, yes, of course, there's oil involved. Yes, of course, rare earth minerals and so on. But a lot of these wars is the United States essentially operating as the forward military force of Saudi Arabia and the Israelis in this area. I mean, let's put it bluntly. That's what's going on here. The United States operates as the forward military post of the Saudi government and of the Israelis. In 2009, the United States government put a terrorism a label on Kataib Hezbollah, which is an Iraqi militia group which has close links to Iran. This is in 2009. It'll come back why this is important. By the way, somebody has their mic open and I'm hearing some noise in the back. So it's a little distracting. If you don't mind just shutting.
I'll take a look.
Yeah, thanks a lot. It's just a little distracting. It sounds like an airport. It's hard to give a talk in an airport. I have tried that before, but it's not easy. So sorry. Anyway, so my sense here is that the Kataib Hezbollah was put on the terrorism list in 2009. Again, this is before the Daraa events. This is before any question of the United States, you know, coming in to help the Syrian people and so on. Okay, so this will become important in a second. The United States goes after the Syrian government. We know that there's a longer history of it, but we know it gets cloaked in human rights. We know that this is a serious problem because even in Libya, the United States following the French and the British, US doesn't always lead, it often follows. As I mentioned to you, the policy in West Asia is frequently United States following the Saudis and the Israelis. On Libya, they followed Nicolas Sarkozy. He really led the file on Syria. It wasn't Hillary Clinton, but she was very gung-ho on this, but he led the file on this. You know, just a few days ago, the Norwegian foreign minister from that period gave an interview, very important interview, where he said that in March 2011, the Norwegian foreign ministry had cut a deal between the rebels in Libya and the Libyan government of Muammar Gaddafi. They had a plan for the transition. Mr. Gaddafi was going to leave, but the state institutions were going to remain. And the French, the British, and the US government scuttled that agreement and deliberately bombed the country without allowing a peace process to develop. By the way, the negotiators from the African Union were sitting on a plane in Addis Ababa, ready to fly to Tripoli. They were. I spoke to several of them. They said they were sitting on the runway, ready to fly. The French had been informed. NATO had been informed. Before their plane could take off, French bombers went and started the bombing run in Libya. So now you tell me, who is the defender of human rights here? Whose game are they playing? One must always contest this idea that the United States is a champion of human rights or civil rights or interested in the people of Syria or interested in the people of Iran. I mean, look at it this way. On the anniversary of when the US prosecuted an illegal war in Iraq, on that anniversary, the anniversary of a war that Mr. Biden supported, Mr. Biden had the temerity to give an interview where he calls Vladimir Putin a killer. I mean, you know, what kind of behavior is this? These people are certainly not credible humanitarians. This is the language of a gangster. You know, this is the language of a gangster. You remember Hillary Clinton's interview after Gaddafi was sodomized and then assassinated on the streets. She said, what did she say? She said, we came, we saw, and we conquered. This is the mindset of the US ruling class. It's not human rights that they want to prosecute, it's this. It is a form of putting power down against other people, oppressing people. This is what, in an earlier period, one called imperialism. When will we use that language again? And when will we be able to take that language to the people so that this is not seen as anachronism, but something that is happening right now? In fact, it's exactly the kind of policy that the United States is prosecuting against China at this moment. Biden. What did Biden do to Syria? There were some rockets fired in Erbil near the airport. And in February, what did the United States government decide to do? They said that the people, Kataib Hezbollah, who were placed by the US government on the terrorism list in 2009, 3 years before the events in Daraa, 2.5 years before the events in Daraa, they said that Kataib Hezbollah and two, three other groups had fired rockets at the airport in Erbil, where the United States has a presence. Why the US has a presence in Erbil, that should be raised in the UN Security Council. What is going on? Why are there still so many US troops in Iraq? Rockets are fired, and then the United States retaliates by bombing two villages on each side of the Syria-Iraq border. They bombed two villages on each side of the Syria-Iraq border, in the name of self-defense. What self-defense? How have these villages at any point threatened the United States government? You place troops or you place contractors in Erbil airport and somebody fires rockets at them. There's no no need for any kind of evaluation or no need for any public discussion. You just bomb anybody. This is a little bit like Obama's kill list. I'm giving you this as a kind of a testimony because I don't have faith in the US ruling class. You see, I don't believe that it's going to be that easy to pressure people in Congress or to pressure the Democrats and so on. I think there needs to be a deeper assessment about the weakness of the human movement, the humanitarian movement in the United States. I read Obama's autobiography. It's called Promised Land, a title itself that made me feel a little ill. I read this autobiography. There's a section where he justifies the kill list, I was very disturbed by that section. And I'm speaking to you because I still feel a little worked up because I remember reading that section. In the section on the kill list, Mr. Obama, who, you know, is a man who doesn't accept the death penalty. You remember this, that he has that history of being a law professor and, you know, was at University of Chicago and so on, and, you know, friendly with liberals and very kind and decent man and charismatic and so on. Mr. Obama, with a record against the death penalty, goes into the White House. He's informed by his national security team. He's informed by all of them that, you know, on, I think it's Thursday, you're going to have to come into the secure room. We're going to show you a list of people and you have to sign at the bottom and authorize the execution by drone strike or other means. It was the kill list. He writes about it openly in Promised Land. And then he said, you know, I had some sort of, I had some qualms about this. But he said, my chief of staff said to me, and this is Obama writing, this is not me putting words in anybody. I don't know if the chief of staff actually said that, but this is what Obama says. He says, my chief of staff told me that a liberal democratic president must not give the appearance of weakness. In other words, United States president, the liberal US president, you know, this great, beloved, great hope of the liberals in the United States, the liberal president comes to his own autobiography, looking back at 8 years of his own tenure as the president, the most powerful man in the United States government, says that he authorized the killing of hundreds, if not more, people because he did not want to appear weak. It's a constitutional lawyer speaking. This is somebody who understands the UN Charter speaking. I did not want to appear weak. Therefore, I authorized the killing of hundreds of people around the world. Now, you come and tell people in Waziristan what they feel about the US government. You come and tell them why they are so angry about what has happened to their lives and why that war in Afghanistan, which seems never to end, regardless of the administration, conservative, liberal, whatever, it's a war that the US ruling class seems to want to prosecute without care for its own morals. How are you going to talk to those people about peace and so on? I mean, I appreciate people going on journeys. Everybody on this call feels terrible about it. But that means that the general strategic orientation to building a peace movement in the US is just not working, because there's just too much faith in the fact that there's a liberal wing of the ruling class that somehow is going to pull itself, extricate itself from this mess that US history has driven the world into. I don't think that's going to happen. It has to be another strategy. I'm happy. I mean, Phyllis is very good at pointing out all the various opportunities. I'm extremely happy that there is the growth of various platforms, the DSA and others, that are taking moderately good positions on many issues. I'm very happy about that. But something else needs to be tried. It's not enough to hope that the Democrats will reform themselves. It's just not enough, because they are not reliable. They are the liberal wing of a wretched ruling class. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Vijay. I appreciate that.